Christmas Eve. Merry Christmas Eve to those joining us via Zoom, somewhere in the Sonoran Desert, or from homes much, much further away. Merry Christmas Eve to those here at Mountain Vista Unitarian Universalist who have gathered out here, chilling on our patio, and huddling together for just a little extra warmth. And there are a few chairs in the middle here if you are looking to kind of get in on that warmth. Yeah. I'm the Reverend Matthew Funk Crary, underneath the hat and the scarf and the jacket and the extra layers. And I want to wish a Merry Christmas Eve to all, whoever you are, wherever you are. We are of high spirits because Christmas is just about here. This evening, through music and singing, reading and reflections, we will share our anticipation for this Christmas 2022. Now, all of our presenters will be wearing masks like I am doing throughout the evening while we are singing or we are speaking, and we would ask those here in person to do the same. This is our way of making our gathering as safe as possible for the most vulnerable among us. And Don't worry, we won't let that interfere with our Christmas gaiety, because Christmas is almost here. And I'm grateful to all the presenters who have brought their Christmases and who have recorded their parts for our Christmas service this evening. Thank you. And there are two people that you will not see this evening who also deserve our thanks. They are Lee and Todd McMealy. They are the audio-visual duo behind the scenes, making sure that we see and hear all of our Christmas cheer. And that makes them a little bit like Santa Claus, right? So thank you. Christmas, yeah. No, please, that's... lots of hours and ingenuity they put in, so thank you. Christmas is almost here. And so with each song, with each reading, with each reflection, we bring it closer. And so let's get started, right? With our opening carol, It Came Upon a Midnight Clear.
Fill your heart with fantasy and song. This is the time to dream and not inquire. If it be true, but let our deep desire inflame our vision, make it glad and strong. To soar beyond our want, it's far from wrong. To seek release, the year's demands conspire against our natures till our souls require the melodies and myths of ages long. The moon is full, the wind sings in the trees, bright mountains call, and clouds and fairies dance. Ideals unborn and dreams half caught await, and we can choose what we shall make the keys to life, shall love and joy and peace enhance the fantasy made trust as we create.
Before our first reflection, I offer you these words of the Reverend Howard Thurman, who just simply reminds us that Christmas is waiting to be born in you, in me, and in all. You see, there isn't a single Christmas waiting to be born. There are many. There are as many as there are of us. There's the Christmas that you anticipate. There's the Christmas I expect. And the Christmas that we all desperately hope arrives. There just might be as many Christmases as there are stars in the night sky. And as Unitarian Universalists, we honor these many Christmases and celebrate the many meanings the season has to offer. Our celebration of this holiday has very strong roots, however, in Victorian England of the 1800s. Now, that was a time of great revival of Christmas and a deeper understanding of its celebration. All of the Christmas carols that we will be singing this evening come from that time period. These carols will serve to assist us in navigating all the firsts and the presents and the futures and the awakenings that Christmas holds for each and for all. And Victorian England was famous for giving us another kind of Christmas carol.
Say a word or two about Dickens and that Christmas carol. Is that all right? And that Christmas carol, which was written in 1843. Now, that's a sad time. It's a very sad time. We talk about that time as the Hungry 40s. People were poor. There were people who were well off, like Scrooge, who could do what they wanted, and Scrooge didn't, as you know, but his nephew did, had parties, had people over, had food, had punch, had drinks, and enjoyed life. People were doing that. As Reverend Matthew said, they were singing and they were enjoying. But at the same time, and Dickens was always very aware of this, there were very, very poor people who were doing nothing of the sort. They were starving, people were starving. He had been traveling around the city as he always did. He was a kind of a flaneur. He went here and there, and he had gone to ragged schools. Ragged schools were schools for children who were so impoverished that they couldn't get to any other school. And they were called ragged because the kids didn't have decent clothes. They were in rags. And he was deeply moved by this. It was a time when Frederick Engels was writing The Condition of the Working People in England, not a happy book. And Prime Minister Disraeli was writing a book called Sybil, the Two Nations, and the nations were the nation of the not poor and the poor, and that was England. So what Dickens did in 1843 was to think about this, and he needed to make some money. The year before, he had written Martin Chuzzlewit, and this book was really something that he expected to do very well. It didn't. And he had a new child on the way. He was going to have 9 children, by the way, in the end. He had a new child on the way, and he needed to make some money. So in late fall of that year, he began to write, and he wrote in a white heat for 6 weeks, and the result was the book that you all know about for tonight, which is The Christmas Carol. And he wrote The Christmas Carol in order to make money, but he wrote The Christmas Carol because he cared, and he really did care about the world that was around Scrooge, who paid no attention to it. It's a world that we see through his eyes, and that we see through the eyes of Scrooge. And as an older person, the older I get, I begin to look back the way Scrooge was and think about Christmases past, but about years past. And what struck me this year was interesting as I reread the Christmas Carol. And that was that I spent one Christmas when my mother was very ill in the hospital in Florida, and I didn't know a soul, not one person. They were having food for people who didn't have a place to go. So I went and I ate with people who had no money. People were so grateful to be there, and I really talked to a lot of people I never would have seen otherwise. And to me, that's what I was thinking about when I began thinking about tonight and about this time, is that we all need to think about the other folks, as Dickens did, on this wonderful night that we all love and that we celebrate here together.
Our guiding carol is We Three Kings. Now, you may have already noticed we're not singing all the verses of all the carols So you do have to pay attention, because you may have a favorite verse that you're ready to just launch into that isn't there. So just keep your eyes on the screen. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph went up to the town of Nazareth in Galilee, in Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and the line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to marry him, and was expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. And she wrapped him in cloth and placed him in a manger, because there was no guest room available for them. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Be not afraid. I bring you good tidings that will cause you great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloth, lying in a manger." And suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to all of goodwill." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which we have been told about." And so they hurried off, and they found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in the manger. And when they had seen them, they spread the word concerning all that had been told to them about this child, and all who had heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things, and she pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told.
The stars are brightly shining. It is the night of the dear.
We've been waiting. We've been waiting and we've been waiting and we've been waiting for just a little bit of peace. Like the generations and generations and generations before us, we have been waiting for a pause of war in this world. An end to strife among so many people. The stopping of struggle here in our own hearts. Just to have a little bit of peace. We've waited alongside so many others throughout the history of our world, waited for so long that I wonder if I would recognize it if it came. I mean, would you? If peace came upon a midnight clear, would you recognize it? If peace came in the body of an infant wrapped in cloth and lying in a manger, would you give it room in your heart? If peace came on this night, a night that we choose to gather and therefore make holy, if peace came tonight, would you celebrate it in song and in laughter and holding tight to all those that you love? I have to believe I would, and I believe we would too, that we would recognize and we would celebrate peace. But you don't have to take my word for it. We could just do it. We could exchange peace as a gift to one another, to ourselves, to our world now. This Christmas, we could join those shepherds, terrified at the promise of peace. We could sing like the angels, the glory of peace among us. And we could come to the manger and simply receive the gift that is lying there, silent and quiet, as a sleeping child. We could receive that gift of peace here in our own hearts. I pray for all of us. We could share it with all of those that are suffering. We could lift it up into our world torn with war. And we need not wait a single moment longer. We can make this night our holy night, as we make ourselves the gift of peace.
For so the children come, and so they have been coming, always the same way they come, born of the seed of two hearts.
No angels herald their beginnings, no prophets predict their future courses, no wise ones see a star to show where to find the babe that will save humankind.
Thank you. Yet each night a child is born is a holy night. Parents sitting beside their children's cribs feel glory in the sight of a new life beginning. They ask, where and how will this new life end? Or will it ever end?
Each night a child is born is a holy night, a time for singing, a time for wondering, a time for worshiping.
Happy Christmas, Hanukkah, and Festivus for the rest of us, and otherwise, happy holidays. I'd like to share with you a stream of consciousness poem that I wrote recently entitled Christmas Present. I ask that you listen with an open heart, and I ask my mascara to be as waterproof as it promised. Christmas Present, right here, right now. I'm here. I'm not hiding out. I'm not shutting down. I'm not running away. I am far from perfectly at peace or merrily lifted by the Christmas spirit. I'm honestly a little sad. But also, I'm glad. And not just because it rhymes, but because I'm here with you, right here, right now. We're here. We're not hiding out. We're not shutting down. We're not running away. This is our Christmas present. This is our Christmas present as in this time and space, but also this is a gift. Right here, right now. Doesn't need to be wrapped and under the tree. This is our Christmas present. Right here, right now, and it is absolutely perfect. Exactly as it is. Flaws and imperfections included, loved ones here, loved ones missed. With its sadness and its gladness, we can hold both. Let's hold both together right here, right now, in this present moment where we are present and it is our present to each other. Let's take this moment to be both sad and glad. Look around and take in all the details of this moment. See the people gathered, old friends, family, our community. Send a loving thought to someone who's away or a loved one lost, but just for a moment. Breathe in the cool, crisp air and let it bring you right back here. Feel the chair beneath you or the hand of someone close by or the coziness of whatever you're bundled up in. Hear the traffic of all the people headed to wherever they're headed this Christmas Eve. Take in this perfect present moment. Yes, the world is complicated. Yes, the holidays can be as painful and brutal for some as they are beautiful and peaceful for others. Yes, we've come through truly difficult times in days gone by. Yes, there are challenges to face when tomorrow comes. But let's be fully here together in this exact moment. And let us be grateful for all the blessings we are sharing tonight, right here, right now, in this our Christmas present. Thank you.
Thank you.
There are very few Unitarian Universalist traditions, period. There are very few Unitarian Universalist traditions for Christmas Eve. But there is one. One that has emerged in my experience across different states for Unitarian Universalist congregations from the Northeast to the West Coast. And that is taking up a collection for the minister's discretionary fund. Minister's discretionary fund is the monies given by the congregation so that the minister of that congregation can assist people in need. Period. To assist people in need. And it didn't occur to me until this Christmas, with all of you, that the reason why it's a Christmas Eve tradition is because we get to give a present to someone. We get to give individuals who are having some kind of financial struggle a small gift. We're not solving their problems, but instead we're giving them the space to breathe, perhaps for the first time in a long time. Giving them the opportunity to step back, to reset, and maybe even to make more sustainable financial plans. It's a gift, and it's based solely on the generosity of the congregation. And that's why we do it on Christmas Eve. If you'd like to participate in the minister's discretionary fund offering, there's our bowl, our wooden bowl, just this side of the Christmas tree that you saw coming in. Just put something in that bowl as you go, and know that that will be part of a present to help those who are in desperate need. A small present, the gift of peace. But it's a gift that we take up on Christmas, and we create a small Christmas for them. Any time of the year.
Apologies to the original author of this poem, I believe Clement Moore. But if he was a UU, I think he would be okay with this. 'Twas the night before Christmas, and all through the house, lots of creatures were stirring, but nary a mouse. The parents were wrapping the toys in their boxes, while children were sneaking around like foxes. please, one more cookie or another piece of gum. The parent said, if you don't go to bed, then Santa won't come. So they hung the stockings by the chimney with care, and one kid said, who is Saint Nicholas? And can I light the menorah over there? And Mama in her fuzzy robe and I in my L.L. Bean Christmas PJs settled down with the chillen for a long winter's discussion of Christianity, Judaism, Buddhism, and Unitarian Universalism. When out in the living room, there arose such a clatter. I sprang from the bed to see what was the matter. 'Twas the cat who was having a huge hissy fit, knocking over the menorah, which of course was lit, into the tree, which erupted in flames, and both kids cried, wasn't my fault, kitty's to blame. Quickly we rose and put out the fire, but the cries of the kids rose higher and higher. We can't have Christmas without a tree. But I gathered them round and said, listen to me. The moon outside shone into the room. I said, don't worry, kids. A burnt tree doesn't mean gloom. The spirit of Christmas is all about love. We don't need a tree, presents, or Santa circling above. We show kindness and compassion to each and every creature, even our grumpy old neighbor and your least favorite teacher. We give gifts to others, not expecting any in return, because the gift of self is what we must learn. All of us have worth, no one is better. And Mom cried, that's the first UU principle to the letter. And remember the next, being fair and kind in human relations, acceptance and spiritual growth in our congregations. We search for truth and the meaning of life, but can still believe in Santa and his wife. Because Santa gives freely of his gifts and his love, whether we are black, white, straight, gay, or none of the above. And what about Jesus or Buddha or Yahweh? We can worship their teachings, their thoughts about love, be it in temple or church, your way or my way. The goal of our world is justice and peace. Freedom for all, our chains we release. So under the covers, we snuggled in bed with visions of prophets dancing in our head. We vowed to awaken with love in our heart and respect for the interdependent web of existence of which we are a part. I kissed Mama and the kids and turned out the light, saying, Happy Christmas to all, and to all a good night.
I'm going to use this mic tonight. It's my turn to talk about Christmas and the future. I'm going to take a very narrow view of the future and talk about it mostly within the confines of the 12 days of Christmas. In my family, we always kept Christmas going, to some extent anyway, until January 6th, the 12th day of Christmas, Epiphany, which in the Christian tradition is the day that two wise men arrived in Bethlehem, that the three wise men arrived in Bethlehem, and when the baby Jesus was baptized by John the Baptist. Part of the reason why we did that in my family was because my sister Mari had her birthday on that date. But it was also because we enjoyed having our big old Victorian house decorated for the season. It brought light and cheer into the cold, often dark New England winter. As a high school teacher of French, I celebrated La Journée des Rois, or Fête des Rois, on January 6th with my students, King's Day. The French tradition is to bake a cake within which a small charm or a fève is hidden. The person who finds the fève becomes the king or queen for the day, complete with a Burger King crown, in my classroom anyway. I will never forget the year when Mark and John, two stars of the football and baseball teams, baked the cake for my fifth year French class. The fève was a 3-inch plastic ballerina figure, which somehow miraculously survived the heat of the oven. For many Americans, Christmas is over and done with in one day. They spend the 26th of December taking down decorations, returning to the mall to exchange presents, or spend gift certificates and take advantage of the post-holiday sales. I think it's a shame that what is often called the spirit of Christmas, the season of peace and joy, does not last longer, even beyond January 6th. During the days leading up to the 25th, we make a special effort to be kind and to go out of our way to help and befriend others who are less fortunate than we. We try to live out our sixth principle. We covenant to affirm and promote the goal of world community and peace, liberty, and justice for all. I'm going to make a Christmas resolution, to make a real effort to carry the work of Christmas into the new year, to continue after I take down the Christmas lights, to do my part to comfort those who are in need of grace, to keep the flame of human compassion burning, and to help create a kinder, gentler world. In that spirit, I'm going to leave you with the immortal words of Elvis Presley. Oh, why can't every day be like Christmas? Why can't that feeling go on endlessly? For if every day could be just like Christmas, what a wonderful world it would be. What a wonderful world it would be.
Tomorrow, each of us will awaken to another Christmas. I hope there will be gifts for you and yours. More than any present that could be placed under a tree, I hope for you an awakening that you are the gift of peace and of love to the world. The characters who lead and guide us to this awakening are many. Choirs of angels, pregnant migrants, wandering sages, generous kings, infant saviors, as well as grouchy Scrooges, jolly old elves, and so many, many more. The variety and choices mean that you can be your own unique gift, drawn from the ancient inspiration or crafted fresh, unlike any ever given before. And so let us anticipate many Christmases tomorrow by preparing our hearts this evening. Let us sing the song of angels, awaiting the birth of of a new day, bringing our gifts to graciously share and healing the hurts of past with love and with joy. Let us wake tomorrow and be the Christmas that our hearts hope for and that we, each and all, deserve to become. Please rise as you're willing and able. Please rise. Standing. When the song of the angels is stilled, when the star in the sky is gone, when the kings and princes are home and the shepherds are back with their flock, the work of Christmas begins to find the lost, to heal the broken, to feed the hungry, to release the prisoner, to rebuild the nations, to bring peace among the people, to make music in the heart. Go in peace and have a merry, merry Christmas.